Hello, and today we're going to be doing Chocolate Overdose, one of the favorite classes that I do on a regular basis. And if you're not familiar, my name is Michael Niksic. I am a chef, and during much of my career, I did pastries. Well-rounded chefs should be able to do pastries and baking. You should not know if anyone's missing in the kitchen and the chef can't do their job. So chefs that can't do baking and pastries, to me, it's an incomplete career. So I made a point of doing pastries and baking early into my career as a chef. And so, some of the things that I've learned, I'm passing on to everybody else. In this class, we're going to be doing chocolate recipes. We're going to be doing a Dutch cocoa whipped cream. We're going to be doing a French ganache. This is the chocolate glaze that's on this cookie. We're going to be doing the cookie itself, which is a peanut butter chocolate chip cookie with toffee pecans. And we're going to be doing a blackberry brandied chocolate sauce. Also too, sitting on top of this right now, is a French chocolate hazelnut ice cream made by hand. You do not need a machine to do this recipe, but that particular recipe is in the decadent ice cream class. So you'll have to switch over and check that one out too as well. Now, when you're going out to get chocolate, as a pastry chef, I've always preferred Callebaut Belgian chocolate. They make excellent chocolate, all purpose, handles anything. Doesn't matter what you want to do with it. Doesn't matter if you want to make a mousse or a sauce. Does not matter. Great chocolate to work with. And you can buy this mostly at Whole Foods. I haven't seen it in any of the other stores yet. And they usually sell it in 1 pound pieces. And usually it comes in a 5 kilo brick. And sometimes they get even bigger bricks, but usually it's a 5 kilo brick. And they'll chop it down into approximately 1 pound pieces. Not necessarily cheap, but in my book, worth every penny of it. Also too, when you're out at the store and you're buying chocolate, make sure that it's at least 65% pure. Then you're getting your money's worth. Remember, cheap chocolate, when it sits in your hand, will not melt. That's because of all the ingredients extra they put into it, like lecithin, milk powder, things of that nature. Purer chocolate, when it sits in your hand, will melt at body temperature. So it'll literally start to melt in your hand. That's the reason M&Ms were invented for World War II for the troops. They wanted chocolate as a boost, an energy boost for the troops. But in most of the climates they were fighting in, like North Africa, Europe, especially the South Pacific, chocolate melts very quickly. So it was a problem. So that's why they put the candy coating on the outside of them and M&Ms came to be. Who knew? So, we are going to get started. If you are on a diet, this is the wrong video to be taking notes on. So we will blow that apart in a heartbeat. Recipes are at the end of the video. Concentrate during the course of the video on the methods. When you learn your methods, the recipes follow very, very easily. Okay, get your heating pants on, ready to rock and roll. Here we go. Okay, we have everything in the bowl that we need to make our chocolate whipped cream. Our heavy cream is in here. Our cocoa powder is in here, confectioner sugar, which is powdered sugar, and also two our extracts, vanilla and almond. And all we have to do is turn it on, and we're going to slowly but surely whip it to a peak. Okay, you can see that it's almost at a peak. All we have to do is whip it for just about a minute, minute and a half more at a high speed, and it'll be at a full solid peak. And we'll watch that happen. You can see it holds its position, all the ridges, nothing moves, nothing sags. Now you know that it's gone as far as it can go, and as much air has been whipped into it as possible. This is the final product. Okay, here we have our ganache and our milk chocolate sauce. The ganache, you can tell because it has more cream in it. They're both going to be made the same way, in a defrost cycle, inside the microwave, in glass bowls, not plastic. I'm going to heat them up slowly. Let them melt slowly and mix them in. If you don't add the cream and the oil first when you make a sauce or a ganache, and you try adding, say for example, brandy like we're going to be doing, or any type of extracts like vanilla or almond, it'll literally seize up and make a cement paste. So you have to infuse oil and some cream into it first, loosen it up, make a thicker version of the sauce, and then add your water-based liquids after that, whether they be an extract or a liqueur. Do it in any other order, you're going to have problems. So don't do that. Do it in this order. Fail safe, foolproof. Okay, here's our chocolate sauce out of the microwave. You can see how smooth and rich this is. Now this is actually almost close to room temperature, so that's why it's getting a little bit thicker. A good chocolate sauce should be thick at room temperature and thin when it warms up. So ideally, this will be a little bit warmer when it's served. Now one of the things that you can do is you can make this thinner, which is actually what we're going to do. So first, we're going to lose this spoon. We'll put it over here for right now. And we're going to come back and we're going to get our promised blackberry brandy. And very gently stir it in. Now if I tried this with the blackberry brandy into straight chocolate, it would just seize up into a rock like cement and not move. But because we've already melted oil and cream into it, it readily takes the brandy without any problems at all. And now all of a sudden you see a nice, much thinner sauce and able to do anything that we want, cold or hot. There you go. How easy was that? Simple and to the point. Now if you're holding anything like this and you're putting it into any type of storage, we recommend putting it into squeeze bottles, because the squeeze bottles can actually handle being put into a microwave on defrost. When the sauces are put into a squeeze bottle, it makes them easy to use, ready to use, and it makes for a really good storage vessel for it. And you can see, just using a simple funnel, and it'll just pour right in. And it's really easy to take a squeeze bottle like this and seal it off. All you have to do is remove the nozzle tip, put a piece of plastic in place, screw it back together again. Saran wrap will do the job quite nicely. Any type of a plastic film will do the same thing. I don't recommend using aluminum foil. Drop it a few times like this. I'll tamp the sauce through a little faster. And there goes the last of it. Now this goes easier and smoother if the sauce is warm, so don't do this when it's cold and congealed, because it'll be a nightmare for you. And we're going to seal it up nice and tight. Just put a piece of plastic over it, just like so, and then you're all set. It's airtight and the tip is protected, so you have no problems with storage. Just put a piece of tape on here, label it as it is, and you're all set and ready to rock and roll. And here we have our ganache. I'm just taking it out of the microwave. And you can see how quickly and easily this incorporated and made into a nice, smooth glaze. Simple and to the point. Now, we're not going to put any extracts into this one. Instead, what we're going to do is we're going to put some oils into it. This particular ganache, what we're going to do is we're going to use some lemon oil. Lemon oil, along with any other citrus oils that you have available to you, very, very potent. So I'm going to use a few drops. And that's literally it. That's all we need. This is the same as if we'd zested a lime or lemon or any citrus fruit and then added it to whatever we're flavoring, in this case a ganache, only there's no pulp from the peel. And just like that, we're done. Simple and to the point. Okay, now we're gonna make some absolutely ridiculously decadent peanut butter pecan chocolate chip cookies. And we are going to use all pure products. We're gonna be using butter and eggs, brown sugar, sugar, toffee-coated pecans. We're gonna be using peanut butter and milk chocolate chips. And when I mentioned the toffee-coated pecans, here we go. And we're gonna whip this into a paste first, starting with unsalted butter and light brown sugar and sugar. And we're gonna cream that until it's smooth. And then we're gonna add an egg, and we're gonna add peanut butter and the rest of our ingredients, salt, vanilla, baking soda, almond extract. The last two items that we're gonna add are the all-purpose flour and the actual garnishes, the chips and the pecans. The reason the chips and the pecans go in dead last is we don't want the mixer to smash them and beat them into little pieces. Okay, and we're gonna start with dropping in our butter. And we're going to add our sugar. And the sugar actually also has the baking soda in it, which is our leavening agent, and a little bit of salt, which the recipe calls for. And here we go. Now you can see we're using a paddle. Don't use a whip, you can break a whip. A dough hook won't do the job. You need to use a paddle. Okay, the inside of your mixing bowl should look somewhat like this after the first phase is done. Shouldn't be any lumps of butter, any lumps of sugar. Either one will cause problems. So we want it nice and smooth. We're going to scrape down the bowl. We're going to give it a couple more runs around. Okay, now we're going to add our egg, extra large. Important on the sizing there, because again, you're dealing with a formula. You don't want to throw off the formula. We're going to add our peanut butter. It's already been measured into 1 cup. And both of these can be added at the same time without any problems. These are all soft, smooth ingredients, so they'll combine very quickly for you. Make sure you get as much out of the measuring cup as absolutely possible. And also, too, whenever you're measuring anything in a measuring cup like peanut butter, or say, for example, shortening, make sure you press down into the cup. And the reason you want to do that is to make sure there's no air pockets inside the measuring cup itself. If there are air pockets, what it does is it reduces the amount that you're adding to whatever it is that you're making, and that throws off the formula. So always make sure that your measurements are precise. And one more time. And you can see the inside of the bowl, everything is nicely combined and be nice and smooth. The paddle is your best option for mixing with this type of a recipe. It's turned off, and we've added a cup of flour to this to start with. I'm going to raise it back, and we're going to start it very slow. Just like so, so we don't end up wearing flour. Not a fashion statement if you're wearing flour. We'll let this stir just for a moment or so. And you can see how quickly it combined. Now we're going to add a second cup of flour in 2 halves. And bring our bowl back up to its normal position. And once again, start it out slow, a couple of short bursts, and then let it mix in.
Okay. Now, see the bottom of the bowl? There's a little bit of the dough that's not mixed properly. Always make sure you scrape the bottom of the bowl completely with a spatula so that everything is combined and mixed thoroughly. Now we have one more half cup of flour to go, and then we'll be ready for our garnishes. Okay, we're going to start our last phase. We've scraped down the bowl. We're going to add our last half cup of flour. We're going to turn our mixer on. Nice and slow, let it incorporate. And then we speed it up. Okay, we're going to scrape the bowl down again, especially the bottom. And we'll get a better angle if we lower it a little. And then one of the things you can do to make sure that it's mixed better is this. Just give it a short burst. Move the paddle out of the way. And then begin the scraping process all over again. Make sure you get down all the way to the bottom. You don't want any flour or sugar or anything else to become a lump. Okay, we've got our bowl scraped down. We're going to give it one last whirl. And here we go. I see one small spot that's not mixed. There we go. And we're all ready. Now, we're going to give you a close-up of the inside of the bowl. And it should look like this. Notice there's nothing on the bottom of the bowl. It's nice and clean. That means that your dough is extremely well mixed and you followed your recipe. Now the final step. We're going to add our garnishes, which are our toffee pecans and our peanut butter chips and our milk chocolate chips. And we're going to add them as the mixture is on low. Done. Everything's mixed. We don't want to smash everything in little pieces. It's incorporated. We're ready to rock and roll. Now it's time to actually press out the cookies and put them in the oven. Okay, we're going to ready our cookies for the oven. A sheet pan, baking paper. And whatever you do, you want your portions to be even. So use a scale, use a measuring cup. In this case, we're going to use an ice cream scoop. This way, all of our cookies will bake evenly. And that anything in a pan, no matter where it's at, should be done at the same time, theoretically, if the oven is correctly regulated and controlled, and it's accurate with its temperatures, and you have good pans. These are stainless steel pans, and they have aluminum and iron cores, so they bake really, really evenly and very, very nice. One of the reasons that we're using baking paper is because we can easily remove the cookies from the sheet straight onto a table, in this case granite, and the granite will suck the heat right out of the cookies immediately. And that's great for cooling without drying them out, and also too it makes it easier to handle them when we peel them off the paper itself. Okay, we're ready. I'm going to start right now. Now one of the things I'm going to show you is the cookie dough itself. Notice how clean it is. It's not crumbly, it's moist, and it doesn't stick to my hand. Those are all the things that you're looking for with the cookie dough. This means that it's extremely well mixed and you followed the recipe. You did well. If it's dry and crumbly, then what you want to do is you want to add a little bit of moisture to it in the form of peanut butter, not water. Or if it's a little bit too sticky, you need to add a little bit more flour to it to dry it up. And just because you get either of those conditions doesn't mean you did anything wrong. You're handling food. And when you're handling food, on a regular basis, there are variables that you don't intend to have. And that's one of the things. Make sure when you're using a scoop, the scoop is full each time. Level it off so that your portions are consistent. Also, too, keep an eye for any clusters of garnishes in the dough, because you want all your portions to be, as reasonably speaking, as equal in dough and garnishes as possible, because that does affect the baking times and consistencies of the cookies. And we're going to do a dozen cookies on this sheet. Now the dough does not spread out. So whatever position you put it in, however you have it laid out on the pan, that's going to be its final resting place. So now you're probably wondering, gee, how do we press this down, make them look nice, how do we get them even? And we're going to show you that right now. Okay, first thing we're going to do, I'm just going to lay a piece of baking paper right over the top of it. Then we're going to take another sheet pan and lay it right on top. And we're going to use this sheet pan to flatten them out. There we go. So to get them to bake evenly, we want them the same thickness. Now that they're evenly spaced on the sheet pan and they've been portioned, we're going to cover them with a piece of baking paper. And then we're going to come back with another sheet pan that's the same size. And it's nice and firm and sturdy, so when we push down on it, it's not going to bend and buckle. And then we're going to push down on it evenly all the way across. Then we're going to look and see, are they the same diameter? We can see that through the paper. We don't have to peel the paper off and look at it. Paper's in place. We can see that this wasn't pushed down quite as far, and these were. So we're going to focus our attention on this section right here. We'll do this. And a little bit better. A touch more. Here we go. And we're in pretty good shape. One more for the corner here. There we go. Peel the paper off. And now they've got nice even baking surfaces. There's no ridges on them. A lot of times you'll see recipes where they'll tell you to take a fork, push it into flour, and then push down on it. The flour that's left behind on the cookie stays flour, and it's always an awful taste. Also, too, when you push down on it with a fork, what happens is you create uneven ridges on the top of the cookie, and the tops of those ridges formed by the fork can easily scorch and burn. So this way we've got a nice even cooking surface, and we'll have a nice even bake out of them. Also too, when it comes time for us to coat them and garnish them, it'll be a much easier job to do. Okay, in a 370 oven, 16-17 minutes, the cookies are done. Now if you notice, as I touch these, they're just a little bit underdone in the centers, which is the way I want them, because I wanted mine to be a soft batch version. And what we're going to do is we're going to literally just pick up one corner of the paper and remove our pan. And just like that, they're done and they're cooling. And once they've cooled, completely cooled, we'll be able to actually move them intact. If we try moving them now, they'll break apart on us. So we don't want to do that. And then once they're cooled off, we're going to put them on racks, and we're going to hit them with a chocolate glaze. Remember that ganache recipe we just did? We're going to put it to work. All right, our cookies are out of the oven, and it's time to glaze them. Now you'll notice we have them on a rack. so that the extra chocolate drips off and goes into the pan below. That way we don't waste anything. Also, two, keep in mind that whenever you're using good quality baking paper, you can use both sides. This is the bottom of the paper that was on the pan. This is the top. You can see that this is still perfectly usable for another batch of cookies. So it's not necessary to throw it out. You can fold it up, put it inside of a Ziploc bag, and have it for your next round of cookies. Okay, we're gonna move on. Our chocolate ganache is now thoroughly melted and ready to go. So you can see here, it'll be easy to put onto it. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna do a little test. We're gonna see if they're cooled off enough, and if this is cool enough, or if we put it onto the cookies, it stays in place and doesn't get too thin. So we'll test it together right now. Yeah, it looks like we're in pretty good shape, huh? It's staying in place, it's not running off the cookie, the excess is dripping off. Perfect combination for what we want to do. Now you can take and you can drizzle the chocolate in any fashion that you wish. You can put it right across the center, do a center stripe. You can do the entire cookie if you're a real chocoholic and you're serious about your chocolate. You can certainly do it like this and just let it drip off to the sides. Maybe you only want to put a dot in the center. So how you do this, totally your own decision. There's no right or wrong way to do this. And if you want to add anything else onto it, say for example, you feel the need to decorate it some more, you can certainly put some sprinkles on it, or whatever the case may be. You've got children in your house, let them decorate, and you can really have some fun with this and be a little creative, especially on a rainy day, or if you're in a stay-in-place orders, as we happen to be these days, you can certainly do that. There you go. Pretty easy and to the point. And then when this has had a chance to drip off a little bit, we're going to replace the rack and we're going to do it again. Now these first batch that you see here have been undercooked intentionally so that the centers are soft, and this is basically still a soft baked cookie. And we're going to take our underused baking paper and use it by removing our rack and setting it down over here and replacing it with a new batch. Now this particular batch of cookies, we cooked more so they're harder, firmer. And we're going to do the exact same thing with them. Now the cool part about this is we can scoop with a spatula the chocolate out of this pan, return it to this plastic container we have here, warm it up again, and use it again. I happen to know somebody that's a ridiculous chocoholic, and we're going to make sure that we take care of them. This will be good for one of those late night movie marathons. You're catching up on TV shows and movies that you haven't seen and you've been wanting to get around to. There we go. And something a little different. And the last of what we have inside this pan. We're all set. Easy and to the point. The ganache will literally harden on its own room temperature. It'll still be soft enough to